Hello, good evening. And it is as it is in Holland here in Europe. My fellow and beloved Genesis and Banks co-fellow fans. You know, you might know the word fan. It's an abbreviation of the word fanatic. So that derived from that word. And we are fanatics. Let's put it right from the start. Well, first, there is something I feel obliged to share with you. It's all about music, of course. What else? And to start with, I want to sincerely thank especially the founders of the great, fantastic Genesis and Tony Banks sites, the people who created them, invented them, built them up. I'm so grateful. Recently, this week, two very, very great Genesis and Banks fans created a new Tony Banks sound site page, a closed community, the Banksians, for example, Miss Christine Fleckenstein from the United States. I'm so grateful. It's dominating my life, you know. I can do nothing else at night. I threw my television into the I threw it up in the backyard. It's the cats play with the parts, you know. It means nothing to me. Since the start, since it commenced on Facebook, the sites of Genesis and Banks got some coffee. It dominates my life. I can't do nothing else. I can't even handle it. I can't even manage it. It's too much. It's never too much, but it's too much to handle at one night, to answer all the people, to give replies, even post new material and interact with all the other fans. And my Facebook account, my own Facebook account, is increasing day by day with new fellow Genesis and Banks fans. It's a miracle, it's a gift from heaven. I'm so grateful. But, what is the matter? What is the matter with us? Why are we so excited, crazy, fond, delirious almost about this music? Especially, there are many, many, many other bands who make great music as well. We all are very fond of, very, very happy with, and enjoy. But tonight, I will talk about Genesis and Banks and all the rest. Steve Hackett, Peter Gabriel, you know them all so well, so very well. Well. When I was 13 years old at high school, first stage, first year on high school, I got my first encounter and discovery of Genesis. That was a moment of it was a mind shift. It was like being elevated, lifted up in a higher dimension. I cannot even find the words to describe what happened to my brains and to my whole body at that moment. In the ambient distance, in the wardrobe of my very tall, huge high school campus, there was a society for the elderly, apprentices for the students. And they made music and smoked pot and drank tea and coffee and things, you know. I didn't fit in there as a child from as 13 years old. There were people from 17, 18 years old over there. But they had constantly music. And once I caught I picked my jacket to go home, and I caught up in the ambient distance the outro, the Tony Banks Strings outro of Seven Stones, Nursery Crime. And something happened, something tremendous happened to me. I was blown away. I went through a wormhole into deep space, into it felt as if my soul was exploded into a zillion of sparkling fragments and all over the universe. And I went to the source. I actually ran to the source of that sound, of that music. And I asked, without any hesitance, the man behind the record player, what the hell? What the fuck is this? Who is this? What is this music? What's the band? He said, let's see. I don't know. Oh, it's Genesis. It's a very not very well known band from England, from Britain, United Kingdom. A few hundred fans in Holland, but I like it. I said, wow, I want to have that. So I ran to the music store. I biked, heart in my mouth, to the music store that afternoon, that very afternoon, and wow, they got it. They got the album. They got only from Genesis, Nursery Crime. And then my whole life changed from that moment on. I didn't leave my room at home with my parents. After 2 months, the record was completely damaged. It was, I listened to it so intensely, so much, so frequently, that all the, you know, that the whole record had to be renewed. It was the time of the big LPs. And well, since then, it has been a great mystery in my life. Why does this music, especially Genesis, but at most, on top of all, the music composed and played by Sir Maestro Anthony Banks, Tony Banks as we know him, his full name is Anthony George Banks, his mother was a concert piano player, so it was already in the family, in his genes. But okay, what happened? This is a medical story. What I'm going to come up with a medical story about music, and it's very interesting. It's amazing. It's mind blowing. I got several friends in the medical world, psychiatrists, surgeons, because it just happened that way. And a friend of mine who is a neurologist, you know, a brain expert, but not a psychiatrist, that's something different, as you all know. He told me from his all the magazines and study material he has to cope with. There's a seminar coming up. A seminar which is going to discover for a selected audience a totally new branch of science. It is called music cognition. Well, there are a couple of professors involved who started it a few years ago, the study project about music. They were fascinated by what does music to a human, and especially to the human brains. And they started with a study group in universities, a neurologist, professor, neurologist, a psychiatrist, professor, psychiatrist, and director, conductor of a Philharmonic Orchestra, who is a music cognition professor. It's a quite new thing. And they started with, first, they started with the effect of ambient surrounding sounds on an unborn child. An unborn child in the womb of its mother, pregnant, reacts unconscious. The brains are active, but unconscious of an unborn child. Well, they discovered that by placing a camera inside of the womb, that the baby, the unborn child, reacts tremendously on surrounding sounds outside the body of his mother or her mother. Music as well. A baby who was 5 months old, and very restless. He was kicking, you know, women amongst you who have children know how it feels. A moving child, a moving baby inside of your womb. And then the mother put headset on, and let her listen to her favorite music. And the mother closed her eyes, felt happy and glorious, and all the best things that music can do to you. And it was so significant that the baby reacted in her womb. It calmed down. It had stopped kicking around and turning around, and it lay peacefully. And a big smile appeared on the face of the unborn child. Wow, that's something. So, it's of utmost importance that parents, especially the mother, who is carrying the baby actually, the unborn child, if she has a sensibility to music and listens to music much during her pregnancy, the baby is influenced by that. The unborn child picks up the music, and there is something happening already in the unconscious brains of the unborn child. Now, the scientific team discovered that a baby from France is born in France, Europe, or in Germany, Europe. They cry differently, very much differently. The German language tends to pitch down, and the French language sounds, the words spoken, phrases, tend to pitch up. So, as a result of that, they tested 600 babies from 1 month, 2 months old, while crying, and recorded that. And what you see as a result is that all babies born in Germany cried in a totally different way than the French babies. They pitched up while crying in France and pitched down while crying in Germany. That's a direct relation to the language that they hear before their birth and after their birth. Now, adults, what is so impressive and important to know for all of us, and that's why I want to share it dearly with you, that not all people are so sensitive to music. I know lots of them. There are people who are totally ignorant. That do nothing with music in their lives. Nothing. Too busy, not interested. In the opposite, there are, like us, in our communities, Genesis Banks communities, are near, you could say music is our lives. It made up our lives. It's so tremendous, of tremendous importance to us. It does so much to us. It touches us. It moves us. It can make us weep. It can make us feel happy and bring great joy. It gives goosebumps all over, shivers up and down our spines. You know, I'm not talking Chinese here. You must understand what I mean. Well, for decades, from my the first discovery of Genesis. What it did to me, it always has been a mystery in my life. Yeah, there were some high school friends who enjoyed the old school Genesis. You know, it ended with leaving of Peter Gabriel. They stuck to the early period, the early era, the Peter Gabriel era of Genesis, and after that they got married, raised a family, got children, and it stopped completely. It went out of their lives. They never listened anymore. And most of the adults I know are similar. They don't have a great band they love, or they listen with headsets on to music, or no, just in the car while speaking to each other, there's something, you know, something on the radio, but they don't pay attention to it very much. And at home they watch TV, or sitting behind the laptop, or the tablet, or the desktop, or playing with the children, or doing something else, but don't listen to music. But a lot of people I discovered, I always felt so much very alone with my extreme passion for Genesis, Banks, all that related material and music stuff. I was a standalone. I could never share it with my people around me. I sent the most beautiful songs, really, that made you cry. You all know them. There was no reaction. They said, "Yeah, it sounds like it's all sounds like it's the same, and I don't hear any difference." And especially with Tony Banks, you know, he's the maestro, who is a standalone on this planet. I studied that for 40 years. He's a standalone and the inventor, the creator of the special, so unique Banks chords, chord changes, which sometimes, or most of the time, could sound twisted or nearly false, but it isn't. It's harmony, perfect, but nearly a higher dimension. And there are not so many people who are able, with their brains, to pick that up. So, many of my friends say, if I let them hear some typical Banks material, that this man cannot play, he's playing false, it's ugly, put it off, you know, they can't comprehend it. But this is just what makes it so special to us. It's the only one, it's the maestro, it's the prog and keyboard god. You just received the award for it, as we all know. Well, the scientific group studied. They got three control groups. They went, they sent them through a PET scan while listening to music with a headset on, so completely isolated. PET stands, it's very, very special scan, and stands for positron emitting tomography. And it gives as a result a high colored, blasting colors of the human brain, of active brain centers. And you can see if you take one slice after the scan has been made, the activity of all the brain centers involved as a reaction to something. The first control group didn't have anything with music. We're ignorant. Just music is something. It's not for me. Just doesn't do anything to me. I never listen to music. Those people. Well, they sent them through the scan with a headset on, and put on some random music, classical, be it rock and roll, be it a ballad, or anything. And as a result, the PET scan, the scan of their brains, was a dark picture. If there is no reaction in the brain center, it gives black picture, there's nothing happening. A few centers are always active in our brains, of course. You could see actually that the brain center that controls our hearing was active, but no emotions. The emotional brain center didn't give any reaction. There was nothing to see abnormal. The second control group who went through the scan, there was approximately 500 persons, each control group. The second control group who went through the scan was neutral about music. Well, it's sometimes nice, sometimes not. Well, I listen to it once in a while, as a background, to invite my friends, or in the car while driving. And they got no specific interest in any kind of music or band or musician or composer, or so they went through the scan with a headset on, random music, and what you could see was nearly the same as the first control group, who had nothing with music at all. And well, there was some reaction, but not very much in the output of the scan. The third and major, this is where it's all about, control group, were people who were crazy about music, who were fond of music, who were out of their heads of some bands or maybe all styles, classical, ballads, rock and roll, rhythm and blues, I don't care, jazz. But they had a specific preference in music which they listened to daily, just like us with Genesis and Banks and Hackett and Gabriel, That control group went through the scan, and they were asked before, which music, which song, which band you like to hear. Of course they choose their favorite bands and musicians and songs and tracks and you name it. And then the miracle happened. The scan output of those persons who went through the scan and with a headset on, listening to their most favorite music, which makes them ignite, which ignites your soul, you know what I mean, because we all got it, we share that. Well, the output of that scan was a shock to all, for the whole team of scientists. They were completely blown off the face of the planet, what they explored, what they discovered. They saw that the whole, nearly the whole of the brains of those people who listened to their favorite music completely was active. It was all the major and minor brain parts lit up in bright colors, and you could see actually the neural pathways interconnected. The brain centers were lit up as well, very bright in several colors, and it's the they discovered that it's the first, it's the only thing in the world, in the life of a human being, listening to favorite music while also isolated with it, so no ambient sounds, no family talking, no friends, just listening, just alone with the music, their favorite music, their most favorite music. It does tremendous much to the brains, positively. They could see that it really, all the dendrites and neurons lit up, and there is a lot of tremendous action and interaction, and all brain centers were talking to each other, were interconnected by the neural pathways inside. It was really a breakthrough in science. It's growing fast, this science of in music, because, excuse me for the coffee, because they already are in the phase, they can prove scientifically that listening to your favorite music frequently and intensely can heal you mentally. It's incredible but true. Even the body reacts in a very positive way. It has got a tremendous positive effect, listening to your favorite music, on your heart, on your totally mental condition, on your whole body. It heals. It's healing. It's incredible but true. They've proven it, because they got, then after that they took two control groups from elderly people who are suffering Alzheimer, you know, the very, very, very bad disease that comes along with growing old. In many cases, people older than 80 years, 85 years, you know, you forget everything. If you got Alzheimer, your brain is literally crashing down and goes to extinction, to full extinction. And they forgot the faces and the names of their own children, and they don't know their own name. They're completely lost, but they don't know. That's Alzheimer. And for a year, the first control group, they did nothing. They just sit in there, you know. They were there's no music, nothing. They lived their lives in the houses of medical treatment, and as we have here in Holland. The second control group, for all the people with a tremendous Alzheimer, who were tremendous sick in their mental state, in their brain, they daily let them listen to by a headset to what their children said once was their favorite music. And what happened? After a year listening daily, 2 hours a day at least, to their favorite music, which they actually were forgotten because of Alzheimer, they the brain started to reconstruct itself. The brain started to ignite again. They, for years, they didn't recognize their own children and the faces of their children and relatives and friends. And but it came back. It really came back. They say, "Hey, John, my son, it's been a long time." My God, that's what music does to your brain. It even can cure people with Alzheimer. And it goes further and further. It's only in the beginning stage, phase of research. And they're going on with it. And it's already been proven scientifically that listening to your favorite music is so very much healthy to your whole system, not only the brains, but your whole body, your whole physical state will react in a very healthy way. You will feel happier during the day. You feel more motivated. You feel more ignited. You feel more sensitive. It does so much. It does so much. They never even could imagine how big the effect of music on our brains and our whole physical system is. It's a new discovery. And I witnessed that seminar. I was a guest together with a very dear friend. We know each other since, for 35 years. He's not like me. I cannot play one instrument, but I can enjoy the music of other players and composers tremendously. All of my life, that's enough. But a friend of mine I took with me to the seminar of this new science is able to, he's a very good, very skilled keyboard player, and he's able to compose. He's a tremendous Banks fan, just like me, but the difference between him and me is that he is able to compose, actually, Banksian-style influenced music on his keyboard. Oh, man, it's driving me nuts. It's driving me crazy. He sends it to me, and I listen to it, and oh my God. It's so beautiful. And, well, you are impressed. After that, there was a complete live Philharmonic Orchestra who played several moods of music, classical music, in interaction with the audience. And they all reacted. If it was a sad, it was a weary piece of music composed by a classical composer, people were sitting like this. Was it uptight and nice and quick, and you know what I mean? There were people were sitting like this. They reacted on it, and well, so it's not. Finally, the two things happened in my life, two miracles, on this very specific subject, is music. First, I'm not longer alone. I'm so, it can bring me tears if, from gratefulness, if I realize that now for shortly, there are large worldwide communities on the Facebook sites of the anniversary of the 40th year of the existence of the Lamb Lies Down on Broadway. There are the Banksians, there are Banks, the Soul of Genesis, there's a lot, there's so much. And now I can, for the first time in my life, I can interconnect and react and with all other diehard Genesis and Banks and things, fanatics, who understand me. We understand each other. You are one big family. And who are on the same frequency, the same vibrance, the same intensity. You all might know the end of Supper's Ready, Apocalypse. Can't you feel our souls ignite? There's an angel standing in the sun. My God. Thank you. Thank you. It's so incredible. I'm not longer alone. But, secondly, finally, it's scientifically proven that it's all true. That we are not nuts, we are not crazy. That we go out of our heads and get goosebumps and shivers all over listening to Banks and Genesis and whatever. It's scientifically proven that it does so much to our brains and our health and our well-being, which endures and builds up during a lifetime. So it brings you in a better, happier, higher state of mind. It's not only when you're listening to the music, it remains. It's just internalized in your system. And to close, finally, I want to share with you that they also discovered that the people who produce music, who make music, who compose music, who play the players, even got a higher brain activity while playing. Totally, the total of their brains lit up in a scan and was interconnected with light of the speed of light. The brain signals travel through dendrites and neurons and neural pathways with nearly the speed of light. It's incredible. Even much more, people who actually make music and create music. So how blessed are they? That might be the reason that people, the members of Genesis, for example, our so beloved Tony Banks, Michael Rutherford, are still so healthy. They never get sick during their lives. I studied that. They don't see doctors and hospitals, and I think that's the direct result of having the community with each other for 40, 50 years now, making their music in chemistry with each other. It's incredible. It's incredible if you see from the Rolling Stones, they're still alive. They still exist. It may be not our cup of tea, but if you look at the man, the world knows him, Keith Richards, the guitar player of the Rolling Stones. This man, for 50 years, took 2 bottles of whiskey each day. He used hard drugs, heroin, coke, everything, speed, you can name it. And this man is 70, 73, and healthy. There's nothing wrong with him. He laughs, and he plays, and he drinks, and he takes his heroin every day. And there's nothing wrong. It might be, it's not yet proven, that because all of his life he was involved in making music with the other guys, you know. And that's a very, very, very interesting thing. I felt obliged to share with you. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you can recognize yourself in it, your own emotions and feelings and what happens to you while listening to our favorite music. And this is what I have to say to you tonight, and I wish you all the best, and I wish we may stay in contact with each other all over the world, sharing our most favorite music, which means so much to us, which means all to me, And most of you, Genesis, Tony Banks, Peter Gabriel, Steve Hackett. It is beyond cognition. It's beyond all understanding. But it's so tremendous. It's so beautiful. It's so fine. I'm so grateful. That's what I wanted to say to you tonight. So bye-bye, my friends. I'm Pierre Henry. You know me from Facebook. You might know me from Facebook. All the best. We meet again, listening to our favorite songs, commenting on each other's posts. It's one big